This time we look at the Born-Haber cycle for magnesium oxide, formula MgO, made up of a magnesium 2 plus ion and an oxide 2 minus ion. So in this particular case we're going to be dealing with a first and a second ionization energy for magnesium, and we're also going to be dealing with a first and second electron affinity for oxygen. So would you pause the slide here and give this a go? Do notice that this is taking 1 mole of O2 and forming 2 moles of gaseous oxygen atoms. So you're going to have to divide that figure by 2. Okay, give it a go then. Construct your Born-Haber cycle and work out the lattice enthalpy of formation for magnesium oxide, please. Okay, so down here we've got the MgO. Solid. First change is to take a mole of magnesium solid and react it with half a mole of O2 gas. That's the enthalpy of formation of magnesium oxide, which is has been given as minus 602. Then we look at the converting magnesium solid into magnesium gas, enthalpy of atomization, or enthalpy of sublimation it could be called. Nothing happening to the oxygen at this stage. The enthalpy of atomization of magnesium is plus 148. Next we'll take a look at the first ionization energy of magnesium forming gaseous Mg plus ions. It'll also generate a mole of electrons. Nothing happened to the oxygen yet. The first ionization energy of magnesium has been given as plus 738. And then we look at the second ionization energy. It'll be much harder to pull an electron off an Mg plus ion than off a magnesium atom. So we'll get Mg2 plus gaseous plus another mole of electrons, so we'll have 2E minus, and nothing's happened to the oxygen yet. Shouldn't surprise us that the second ionization energy is going to be much bigger, and it is at plus 1451. That's a plus figure. Next, what we'll do is we will split the oxygen molecules into oxygen atoms. So nothing's happened to magnesium ions. We've still got gaseous Mg2 plus ions. Still got 2 moles of electrons. But we create a mole of gaseous oxygen atoms. Now, in this question, we were provided with the enthalpy change to convert 1 mole of O2 to 2 moles of oxygen atoms. So we need to divide that figure by 2. And the enthalpy change for that reaction turns out to be half of 498, so that's 299 plus 299. Now, next we have the first electron affinity of oxygen, and that will create, what we'll do is we'll use just 1 mole of these electrons here, so we'll have Mg2 plus, plus E minus now, and we'll get O minus gaseous. Magnesium's gaseous and the oxygen's gaseous. Now the first ionization energy, first electron affinity for oxygen has been given. That's minus 141. Then what will happen is we'll have the second electron affinity of oxygen. Now this is a positive value. When the first electron goes in, an attraction is formed. We will get repulsions as well. Obviously, as another electron goes in, we get more repulsions. But the attraction resulting outweighs the repulsions, and the first electron affinity is exothermic, a value of minus 141. But when the second electron goes in, the repulsions outweigh the new attraction formed, and in fact, it's considerably endothermic, with a value of plus 798. And we now have gaseous Mg2 plus ions. We've used up the remaining 1 mole of electrons, and we've got now O2 minus gaseous ions. And of course, the final change from here down to here is the lattice enthalpy of formation. So we have all the energy changes that we need. We have to sum these values up. Again, unfortunately, I don't have room on this slide to do it horizontally, so I'm forced to do it down the left hand side. But you should have your brackets all put in horizontally and show the examiner how you put your values in. So I'm going to change from, I'm looking at the energy change here, from here down to here. In fact, let me just check back a second. We wanted the lattice enthalpy of formation, yes, so correct, we want this particular energy change. Now, to go from here down to here is the same as these other changes. Let's go down here first of all, and that's the reverse of the arrow here. So instead of plus 798, we have minus 798. Let me take a moment over that. We see that the arrow here for this change is going up the ways, whereas I'm coming down. That's why I have to reverse the sign here, so it's minus 798. So I've got to here so far, this level. I'm now going to work my way up. Again, the arrow's going in the wrong direction, so I have to change the sign here to plus 141. I've now got to this level, and I'm going to work my way down. The arrow's going in the wrong direction, that's why I'm putting in minus 299. Coming down here, the arrow's going in the wrong direction, which is why I'm putting in minus 1451. I'm going down here, the arrow's going in the wrong direction, which is why I'm putting in minus 738. I'm going down here, the arrow's going in the wrong direction, which is why I'm putting in minus 148. And lastly, I head down here, the arrow's going this time in the correct direction, so we put it in as minus 602. And we sum up those seven energy changes to get the energy change we need, the lattice enthalpy of formation of magnesium oxide, and that gives us a grand total of minus 3,895 kilojoules per mole. Hope you got that. Let's look at this next part of the question. Pause this slide and give this some considerable thought. See what you can come up with. Well, as we go down group 2 from beryllium to magnesium to calcium and so on, the atoms are getting bigger. So they get bigger as we go down. Equally, as we go from Be2 plus to Mg2 plus to Ca2 plus, the ions again are getting bigger. And the charge density is therefore decreasing. So in terms of melting point, as we go down group 2, this is group 2 we're looking at, as we go down group 2, the melting point generally decreases, it generally falls. This rule breaks down between calcium and magnesium. Magnesium does have a lower boiling point than beryllium, but it also has a lower boiling point than calcium. So the rule is broken there. And like in many cases, in many phenomena that we have in chemistry, the phenomenon is not always explained in terms of one characteristic alone. And the reason for this break in the sequence is because the melting point is also controlled by the type of structure that the ions adapt. Now, beryllium and magnesium both have a structure which is described as hexagonal close-packed, whereas calcium and strontium have a structure known as face-centered cubic, and indeed barium has a different structure again, referred to as body-centered cubic. But the melting point in general decreases as you go down group 2, and this could be explained in terms of the atoms getting bigger, the charge density falling, and as a result of charge density falling, the attractions between the cations and the sea of electrons become weaker. It takes less energy to break it apart. Turning now to what's more relevant, the trend in the ions. Again, as we go down group 2, the ions get bigger, the charge density falls. And to turn to the answer to this question, this will have an effect on the first and second ionization energies of these particular atoms. So if we compare beryllium with calcium, it'll take more energy to remove an electron from a beryllium atom than from a calcium atom. Why? Well, I know that calcium has got a higher charge in its nucleus. It's got 20 protons after all. But there are two things that can be used to explain why it's harder or more difficult to remove an electron from a beryllium atom than a calcium atom. For a start, the electron in question is closer to the nucleus because the beryllium atom is smaller. And secondly, there are less shells between that outer electron and the nucleus, so there's less shielding. Now, when it comes to the lattice enthalpy, if we compare BeO with MgO, because beryllium, the beryllium ion Be2+, has got a higher charge density than Mg2+, I would expect that the lattice enthalpy formation would be bigger for beryllium oxide, because beryllium, being a smaller ion with the same charge, will form stronger forces of attraction between it and the oxide ions than in the case of magnesium and oxide ions. Okay, thank you for listening.